Blackmagic Design have just launched the public beta for version 20 of DaVinci Resolve, and my goodness, does it pack a punch. There's so many new tools to look at, but I'm predominantly a video editor who does a little bit of motion graphics work as well as color grading, so we're just gonna focus on the best parts of this update for me, well, for the edit and color page. Off the bat, I'm not a Fusion guy, but it looks like there are a ton of Fusion updates, so go and check those out too. All right, let's start with the big ticket item for me, and it might sound kind of boring, but it honestly might also keep me from dipping into After Effects on a lot of projects, and that's the new keyframe editor on the edit page. This has been my number one gripe with Resolve as a daily driver for the past 5 years or so, the absolutely terrible user experience in trying to do even the most basic keyframe animation on the edit page, but they've fixed it. They've finally fixed it. And yes, we could dip into Fusion to do a lot of this, but as I said up the front, I'm not a Fusion guy, never have been, might never will be. I'm much more comfortable with After Effects, even if that does mean round tripping, but those days might be over, my friend, because you can now easily manage your keyframes in the edit page. Now, 9 times out of 10, what I'm trying to do with basic keyframe animation is either make some text move or make an asset like an image or a graphic file move, just to add a little something something to the edit without going full tilt into motion graphics. And that used to be like pulling teeth here in Resolve. But now they have this fresh keyframe module up here on the top left, and that expands to show us all of our keyframeable parameters for our selected clips. So let's just make this title animate in and out as an example. With our clip selected, we then open up the keyframe tab and let's make this title pop up from the bottom of the frame, ease into place, and then do a little zoom bounce thing. Pretty basic stuff, but that in itself would have been a real pain to do in the previous iterations of Resolve. I'll drag the playhead to the start of the timeline in the keyframe editor, move my Y position in the inspector to my desired starting point, and click this button here to create a keyframe. Then move forward in time with the playhead, bring my Y position back to the center, which will automatically create another keyframe. Then I can select both of those keyframes in the keyframe editor, hit the little keyframe curve button up here, and add an ease in and out, which will convert my keyframes to give them bezier handles. And again, if you're familiar with keyframing in After Effects, this is super simple, super basic rudimentary stuff, but yeah, new here. You can then edit the curve by dragging these handles, and it's a bit easier to see if you zoom in up here. Also, if you hold shift before you start dragging these keyframe handles, it'll lock to the desired parameter without holding shift. You're going to kind of end up shifting those numbers, so just know that going in. So now we have a snappy animate in, let's do the zoom. I'll go back to the parameters, find where I want the zoom to happen. Let's just say slightly before the end of our position animation. We'll keep the zoom X and Y locked, create a keyframe, and then move forward in time, bump our zoom up, then forward in time again, and reset that zoom back down to 1, creating a little bump animation. Again, we'll select those keyframes and edit the easing in the curve editor. Now that we have a couple of different parameters in here, it can be a little bit tricky to see what's going on. So as we now want to focus just on the zoom keyframes, let's turn off the position ones by clicking on parameters, going to video, and deselecting the ones that we don't want to see. And just like that, some super simple animated text right here in the edit page. If you do want to finagle the timing, you can turn on the timeline keyframe tray down here, which will give you a visualization of where the keyframes sit in relation to everything else going on in your timeline. And you can grab keyframes and tweak the timing down here, like so. Now, don't get me wrong, I love this update, and it's something that I've been really hoping would come to Resolve for years now. If I am being really picky about it, something I'd like to see in the future is to improve the functionality of this by actually being able to change the parameters up in the keyframe editor. So instead of creating a keyframe over here on the left and then changing the parameters over in the inspector and then going back and forward, I'd like to be able to just change them over in the keyframe editor and go about my day. It's a small gripe, I know, but overall, I'm not complaining. I really like this update. Okay, on to the next one. Sticking with the text animation angle, they've added a new text tool called MultiText, which allows you to create detailed multi-line text-based graphics within a single timeline clip. So instead of stacking a whole bunch of different text effects on top of each other, if you want different fonts or colors or sizes for each line, you can now do all of that in one clip, keeping your timeline nice and tidy. However, if you do want to animate that text like we just explored with the keyframe editor, it needs to be done in separated clips. Otherwise, you're just animating this multi-text clip as one versus individual lines. You can add keyframes to the center of different lines within the multi-text clip. However, those don't appear anywhere in the keyframe editor. I don't really know where you're supposed to kind of manipulate those or manage those. That might get updated in the future. This is a beta release for now, so we'll see how that progresses as we move forward. Anyway, moving on. This video is brought to you by Envato, the unlimited creative subscription. The broadest range of categories, everything that you need to make great videos. Follow the link in the description and start creating now. All right, let's talk about AI. These are some of the biggest ticket items coming to Resolve in this update, and amongst them are things like AI IntelliScript, a functionality whereby you can upload a bunch of rushes as well as your script, and the AI will deliver a rough cut based on that script, picking what it deems to be the best takes and also giving you a timeline full of alternative takes to choose from. I haven't yet had time to put this through its paces properly, but this is a pretty incredible update if it works as demonstrated. Another AI tool that I think I'm going to use a whole bunch is the AI Music Editor, which will extend or shorten the duration of a music track to your desired length by finding natural edit points within the track and looping sections to create lengths that will fit your edit, or just repeating sections. I mean, honestly, this is what we already do as editors, but we do it manually, so it's nice to be able to speed up that workflow, which can sometimes be a bit tedious. This is also something that has been available for Premiere Pro for some time, so it's nice to see it over here in Resolve, as that's currently my daily driver. You can also turn on beat indicators, which are snappable, so you can easily see where the beats are in your music track and cut to those beats. Again, this is just very simple everyday editing techniques, but anything to speed up our workflow is a gift, in my opinion. In terms of audio mixing, the AI Audio Assistant is going to analyze all of your audio tracks and do a pretty professional audio mix on them, saving you time and making your videos sound tip-top. Now, in this day and age, editors are expected to sort of be across everything from motion graphics, color grading, audio mixing, and that's like 4 different jobs. So if you don't have access to a professional audio post house with engineers that have decades worth of experience and have traditionally fudged your way through an audio mix for video as best you can with the tool's time and skill at hand, ask me how I know. Well, then this tool is going to be something that I definitely think you'll want to check out and use. I've not put it through its paces yet, but the demo looks very promising.
A lot of our bread and butter has been these National Geographic expeditions, and this time...
If you are interested in sound design for video and you sometimes work in Premiere Pro, be sure to check out our new video, Basics of Sound Design in Premiere, that we put out recently here on the channel. It's an absolute banger. Yet another AI audio tool that is interesting but could be a little bit controversial is the AI Voice Convert tool, which takes a pre-generated voice model and then converts audio on your timeline into spoken dialogue in that voice model. And you can generate your own voice models from your own dialogue recording on your machine. So let's say I'm working on a video and there's one line we need to get from our video host that may have been flubbed on the day, or, you know, we just forgot to record. I can generate a model of their voice from the rest of the dialogue recording. Then I can record myself saying that line, drop that into the edit, and then I can use the AI voice converter and select the model that we generated from our talents dialogue. And in theory, it should convert my little voice recording to theirs in hopefully a usable way. Now, you can see where controversy might arise here. So in my scenario, of course, I'm reaching out to the talent, letting them know what I'm doing and that I'm going to get additional voice lines from this kind of AI tool. But there's probably use cases here where it could be used in less professional ways. So the jury is out on the ethical side of things. Technically, though, this is a really great tool. But let's be honest, we already have access to AI voice generation tools like this in many places, including with a subscription to Envato, where you can just jump on VoiceGen and select one of a bunch of great voice models and convert text to realistic speech to use in your project. So this tool, having it in a professional editing setting with the option of generating a voice to match the one already in your edit is very handy, I think. And the final audio tool I'll talk about is the Dialogue Matcher, which allows you to take audio profiles from one dialogue clip and match that to another, even when they're recorded in completely different locations. For instance, in the demonstration video, they have one guy in a large, more kind of echoey room and one in a more contained studio, and they're able to somewhat match the two tone profiles so that it doesn't sort of stick out like a sore thumb in the edit. Very much a nice to have. Finally, let's talk about some of the color page improvements here in Resolve 20. In the color warper, there's a new chroma warper that allows you to create more natural looks in a more intuitive way when shifting the hue of different details within your image. So gone are the days of shifting a hue, say, for instance, the color of someone's clothes, and then having it warp sort of everything else in the background just a little bit along with it, meaning that you have to then create a bunch of masks and all that fun stuff. Now you can just intuitively move a slider and get fine natural control over the colors and hues within your image. And the other big one in the color page is improvements with the Magic Mask. It's the same tool you know and love, but now it's boosted to be a much more high-performance version of that tool in terms of accuracy of the selection and the accuracy of the track. So play around with that, see how it works for you. There's honestly so much in this update that I'm excited to play with. I really just need to get stuck into a few projects and use all of these tools and see what I'm using, what's coming in handy, and what I would still kind of like to see from future updates in the program. Some of the other new features, which I haven't detailed in this video, but I'm just as equally buzzed about, include the voiceover function in the edit page, the animated subtitles, and the new reactive vertical video workspace, which will make creating social content just that little bit more enjoyable, and the ability to decompose PSD files in place on the timeline for control over layers, the updates to the film look creator and noise reduction over in the color page, and the list kind of goes on. There's like over 100 new features. So what are you most excited about in this update? What's got you itching to jump into Resolve 20? Let me know in the comments. Until next time, happy editing.